Hi guys, I'm going to deal with potassium sparing diuretics. Potassium sparing diuretics are sulfonamides with weak diuretic property. These drugs are further classified as aldosterone receptor blockers and epithelial sodium channel blockers. Drugs included under aldosterone receptor blockers are spironolactone and eplerenone. Epithelial sodium channel blockers include drugs like amiloride and triamterin. You can remember these drugs with a mnemonic SEAT, where S stands for spironolactone, E stands for eplerenone, A stands for amiloride, and T stands for triamterin. Coming to the mechanism of action, these drugs act in the late DCT and the collecting duct. Before going to the mechanism of action of potassium sparing diuretics, let us see the normal physiology happening in this region. Here, on the liminal membrane of principal cells, there are epithelial sodium channels that transport sodium ions from the lumen of collecting duct into the principal cells. These sodium ions are further transported to the interstitium through sodium-potassium ATPase pump present on the basolateral membrane of principal cells. In exchange with this, potassium ions are secreted into the principal cells through the same pump, that is sodium-potassium ATPase pump. Sodium reabsorption from the collecting duct makes the lumen of collecting duct electronegative, as a result of which potassium ions are secreted into the collecting duct through potassium channels present on the liminal membrane of principal cells. Sodium reabsorption over here is regulated by aldosterone. Aldosterone binds with mineralocorticoid receptors present on the principal cells. This results in formation of aldosterone receptor complex. This complex in turn binds to the nucleus, resulting in transcription of genes, translation of mRNA, and production of aldosterone-induced proteins. These proteins increase the availability of epithelial sodium channel and sodium-potassium ATPase pump and also their activity. Thus, under the influence of aldosterone, sodium reabsorption is taking place in the collecting duct. When potassium-sparing diuretics like spironolactone is administered, it binds with mineralocorticoid receptors present on the principal cell and blocks this whole mechanism. When drugs like triamterin and amiloride are administered, they block epithelial sodium channel present on the liminal membrane of principal cells and reduce reabsorption of sodium and excretion of potassium ions. Finally, potassium sparing diuretics potentiate excretion of sodium ions in urine and prevent potassium ions from excretion. Coming to pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetics of aldosterone antagonists. These drugs have a slow onset with prolonged duration of action. They are highly plasma protein bound. They have high first pass metabolism. These drugs are toxic in hepatic and renal failure due to formation of active metabolites. Coming to pharmacokinetics of epithelial sodium channel blockers, bioavailability of triamterin and amiloride is 50% and 20% respectively. Triamterin is metabolized to 4-hydroxytriamterin, which is an active metabolite and so toxic in hepatic and renal failure. It is excreted in urine. Amiloride is excreted unchanged in urine. These are the dosage forms of different potassium sparing diuretics. Coming to pharmacodynamics, all these drugs produce mild diuretic effect due to mild increase in excretion of sodium and chloride ions. Urinary excretion of potassium, hydrogen, calcium, and magnesium ions is decreased. Hyperuricemia occurs on chronic use due to enhanced reabsorption of uric acid and PCT and reduced excretion. Coming to clinical uses of aldosterone antagonists, you can remember these uses with a mnemonic HORN, please, where H stands for essential hypertension, heart failure, and hirsutism. O stands for edema. R stands for refractory ascites. N stands for nephrotic syndrome. And please as PCOS. In case of essential hypertension, these drugs are given in combination with other diuretics to potentiate their antihypertensive effect and reduce hypokalemia. In case of heart failure, spironolactone is administered along with ACE inhibitor to reduce renal loss of potassium and magnesium and increase the survival time. Anti-androgenic effect of these drugs is used in treatment of hirsutism and PCOS. These drugs are also used in edematous conditions like Kahn syndrome, hepatic cirrhosis, and nephrotic syndrome. Spironolactone is a drug of choice for refractory ascites. Coming to clinical uses of epithelial sodium channel blockers, you can remember these uses with the mnemonic HPLC, where H stands for hypertension, P stands for pseudoaldosteronism, L stands for lithium toxicity, lithium induced nephrogenic diabetes insipidus and Liddle syndrome. C stands for cystic fibrosis. In case of essential hypertension, these drugs are given in combination with thiazide and loop diuretics to reduce hypokalemia. In case of pseudoaldosteronism, tramadol is used to reduce hypertension and hypokalemia. Amiloride is a drug of choice in lithium toxicity. In case of lithium induced nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, amiloride blocks the lithium transport into collecting tubules. In case of Liddle syndrome, these drugs are used to reduce hypertension. In case of cystic fibrosis, amiloride improves mucociliary clearance. Coming to adverse effects, you can remember these adverse effects with mnemonics like triple H stitches and NCD, where H stands for hyperkalemia, H stands for hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, H stands for headache, N stands for nausea, C stands for CNS side effects, D stands for diarrhea. Here, hyperkalemia is due to prevention of excretion of potassium ions in urine. Hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis is due to alteration in chloride and bicarbonate ion excretion. CNS side effects include confusion, lethargy, drowsiness, and ataxia. Coming to adverse effects of tramadol. Amiloride is preferred over tramadol due to many adverse effects produced by tramadol. You can remember these adverse effects with a mnemonic PRIMED, where P stands for photosensitivity, R stands for renal stones, I stands for interstitial nephritis, ME stands for megaloblastic anemia, and D stands for dizziness. Coming to contraindications, these drugs are contraindicated in patients with renal failure, hepatic failure, and hyperkalemia. Coming to precautions, you can remember these precautions with a mnemonic BAT-PG, where B stands for beta blockers, A stands for AC inhibitors, D stands for diuretics, P stands for peptic ulcer disease, and G stands for gastritis. Potassium sparing diuretics should be avoided in patients on beta blockers or AC inhibitors. Use of two potassium sparing diuretics should be avoided. Spironolactone should be avoided in patients with peptic ulcer disease and gastritis. Coming to drug interactions, you can remember the drug interactions with mnemonic DNS, where D stands for digoxin, N stands for NSAIDs, S stands for salicylates. The clearance of digoxin is inhibited by spironolactone, NSAIDs inhibit the action of spironolactone and tramadol, salicylates decrease diuretic activity of spironolactone.